So this time on Customer Tech Talks, I'm joined by Jamie Gunn from JM Family, who have made a really, really high velocity move into Azure. But before we jump into the interview, let's take a look at the video.
JM Family Enterprises is a large $17 billion organization. We are the exclusive Toyota distributor in the southeastern United States. We also have organizations that finance vehicles, that lease vehicles, and we also provide warranty services. The sale of the vehicle is the key to everything that makes our organization run. So everything that we do in our organization is around helping remove waste out of that equation and to help our dealers be able to sell more vehicles and provide an excellent service. A white glove experience. Customer service is at the forefront of all processes that we do with our customers. We use a lot of Microsoft technology at our organization, everything from Microsoft Windows servers, Windows desktops, Azure Active Directory. Over the past year, we've really been expanding into the Microsoft Azure platform, which is our platform for innovation and differentiation, and is really the key to how the organization is going to be structured as we move forward into the future.
So I'm joined by Jamie Gunn, technology architect from JM Family. Jamie, great to have you with us.
Thank you for having me.
Now, JM Family have made a really fast move to Azure. Can you step us through the process you took and how cloud adoption frameworks helped you with that move?
Yeah, absolutely. So we took a very, I would call it a very process-oriented and step-by-step fashion in terms of adopting the platform. But I want to kind of take us even back a little bit in terms of how do we become aware of the platform. So the organization, a number of colleagues and I went to the Microsoft Ignite conference and we took a look at the platform. We had said, wow, they really have come a long way. We had reviewed the Azure platform a couple of years prior and it didn't seem quite as strong as maybe some of the competition out there. There was maybe some lacking in the UX and things of that nature. But then when we saw some of the demos on cognitive services, we were blown away by how easy the APIs looked to be able to be used. We saw the portal itself had a much higher degree of user experience. And everything just had a polish that it hadn't had when we had looked at it prior. So we all got together and we said, let's put together a pilot. Let's figure out, can it really do what it appears to do? Or those guys that are just demoing and just really kind of know which keys to push and you know where to put their mouse and you know so they don't screw up the demo, right? And so we put together a quick pilot and we found the platform actually met what it promised. We were able to put together a usable application in a matter of a couple of weeks. It wasn't very complex or anything of that nature, but it allowed us to kind of kick the tires and see what's going on. Now, at that point in time, the organization hired a new CIO. And this kind of the stars aligned at this point in time because he came in with a mantra of better, faster, and cheaper. And he also had a strong affinity for Microsoft products at the time as well. So now if we fast forward a little bit, the organization did some back and forth and decided, yes, we're going to select Azure as our platform for differentiation and innovation. This then allowed us to spin up a project and start the process. So the first thing that we did, though, when we started that journey is we had to take a real look at ourselves and say, okay, what are we strong at and what are we not strong at? And we kind of identified all of those types of things. And we said then, great, we're going to create some principles. We're going to create some product principles that allow us to make decisions as we're moving forward. Because anybody that's ever works with tech guys knows you get all the tech guys in the room and you know everybody has a different opinion on what is best and what is not best. And this allowed us to really to take a really structured way, a look at how we make decisions. Then we married that up with the CAF framework, right? And that was fantastic. So Microsoft came in, they had a very structured process, allowed everybody to kind of think in a very consistent way. We went through the, you know, the strategy, the planning, the readiness. We talked about adoption, all that type of work, and we put together a plan. We lined that plan up against our principles, and then we were off. By being very structured, allows us to do things in a very predictable fashion. And remember that one of the people that we're working with, Susan, had this statement she always made. She goes, "You can skip the steps, but the steps remember." And that's something that is actually always has resonated with me, and I really appreciate that because that really allowed us to make sure that we did not do that.
So that's really great to see and amazing to see how quickly you kind of made that shift over. Now, in addition to that, you mentioned that you were really impressed by the cognitive services and the AI and ML approach that Azure provided. You started to kind of jump into that work pretty early on as well, and you've made some great leaps and bounds there. Can you share a little bit about that?
Yes, the ML was a complete surprise. We were not expecting for us to be able to adopt that capability on the platform as fast as we did. We essentially, after we readied the platform for software development purposes, we jumped in and started learning about how does Azure ML work. And what we ended up doing in a relatively short period of time, I believe it was about 3 months or less, we ended up generating a completely automated process. We basically built out a four-step process that allowed us to prove through real life, real world use cases that we can actually leverage an MLOps opportunity at the organization. That pilot, that close working relationship with the business proved to be super valuable that we now have kicked off a fully fledged project where Azure ML and machine learning in general is going to be a large part of the strategy for the organization moving forward. So it was a complete success.
Now, I know you've had some really, really amazing progress made in your move to Azure and using certain pieces of the platform as well. But not everything was as serendipitous and straightforward in your experience. I know you said you made some kind of missteps or decisions that you needed to kind of reevaluate on the way through the process. Can you share how that affected your progress and what those decisions were?
Yeah, so I would say that we had two things that we learned along the way. So one was around the leveraging of technology, in this case, Azure Blueprints. So as we were building out, following the CAF model, creating our landing zone, we were hoping that we were going to be able to use Blueprints in a way that we could slowly iterate over our landing zone and create out an enterprise level landing zone. We thought that we could start small and quickly iterate, create management groups, create subscriptions. We're following Microsoft's philosophy of keeping it very simple. And then we found out, okay, as soon as we wanted to start iterating the first time and improving it, the landing zone was going to have to be destroyed and then rebuilt. And we said, okay, that's not going to work. We actually have dev teams using this. We can't just pull the sheet from under them and say, okay, you got to start over again. Sorry about that. So that was something that we had to learn from. And I would say that Microsoft did a wonderful job of kind of coming in, helping us make the shift away from leveraging Blueprint into leveraging ARM templates and the pipelines and things of that nature. So it didn't cause us any impact from our timelines or supporting the organization, but we did learn that there are things that where we probably could have done a little bit better job of vetting out that technology and challenging some of our assumptions. Additionally, something that we learned in the organization is we felt like when we started this effort that we knew who our customers were. We felt that we knew that how we were going to communicate and that we were going to have we're going to over communicate, communication strategy. We thought we knew everybody we're going to talk to. We had, we were running Scrum teams every day. We had demo days every 2 weeks. We were sending out emails, on a monthly basis. We were communicating like crazy, and we found out then as the project was going on and other parts of the organization started learning what we were doing, they're like, hey, we want to be part of this, and all of a sudden we found, we got to slow down a little bit because we got to let everybody catch up. And so that was a lesson learned in the sense that you would think it's a very elementary lesson, something that everybody knows about, right? Know your customer. And yet again, despite all of our best efforts, we saw that there was still room for growth even in that case as well.
That's really great. And I love the way you kind of refer to your business units within the organization as your customers. Cause I think as IT, we tend to think of them as just the business that, is always asking stuff of us. So it's really great to see that you're serving them in that way and kind of seeing them as the people who keep you going, which is awesome. Now, you also set up a kind of self-service model as part of this, and you had some lessons you learned specifically around governance in that kind of approach with the business. Can you talk about how you set up that governance model and how you dealt with that?
Yes. So self-service is very much a key to as we are moving forward in the organization in terms of creating velocity for our development teams. Anybody that's been part of traditional IT is aware of the whole idea, okay, I need a server, so I'm going to wait, I'm going to make my request, wait a month, right? It comes back, it doesn't quite meet the specs I need, I got to send it back out, right? Everybody's very aware of that. And we said, we need to eliminate that. We need to create a model in which our delivery teams have the ability to provision their own infrastructure there and be able to deploy their own code. So a true DevOps mentality is what we were building out. So along that way, people would say, well, okay, great. Are you just going to let people have access to the portal? And everybody would know that would probably be a very poor decision, right? Because next thing you know, people are provisioning, SQL databases that are costing them $10,000 a month and aren't running anything, that are sitting there in dev. So we created a lot of, I wouldn't call it a lot of process, but we created a lot of guardrails that we then leveraged Azure pipelines to enforce for us. So the biggest thing is that we created a standard tagging process that allows us now to have a consistent cost management model. So we create accountability in terms of what people are deploying via cost. We essentially send them the bill, right? They're our customers, so we send them a bill. We also have a number of policies that we have in terms of, you know, the types of services that we allow folks to use in the Azure services. And then we have a number of security policies that we employ as well, because that's very important to the organization. And we tie all that together via Azure pipelines. It guarantees that all services are going to meet our minimum thresholds so that we have a quality control process, we have a cost management process, and we have it, and it's governed from a security perspective as well.
That's great. Really amazing to see the progress you've made, and really impressive to see how mature your deployment of Azure is, even given the fact that it's still so new in the organization. Really, really, really amazing progress. Jamie, thank you so much again for joining us on Customer Tech Talks. It's been great to hear your story and how you've made the most of Azure and the Azure platform.
Yep, thank you for having me.
So we just saw the interview with JM Family and how they use Cloud Adoption Framework to migrate to Azure at velocity. Now I'm really excited to invite Wayne Meyer, who is the Cloud Adoption Lead and worked with JM Family on their migration. Wayne, great to have you with us.
Hey, thanks, Ben, and I appreciate the invite.
Now, as we said during the interview and moments ago, is that they use Cloud Adoption Framework to be able to help their migration into Azure at velocity. But I really was hoping you could tell us a little bit about what Cloud Adoption Framework is and how this helps customers with their migration.
Yeah, so the team from JM Family, and Jamie in particular, they were just phenomenal in terms of taking the guidance and being able to apply it. The Adoption Framework really is our best practice around guidance into cloud, addressing everything from helping build out a business plan through to kind of establishing your platform into kind of building out their applications and workloads. We've taken this across numerous customers worldwide, battle tested, and we continue to build and continue to evolve that environment and the guidance based on feedback that comes in real time.
Right. So it sounds like there's a lot of really great tools and processes to help customers. But if you don't mind, what I'd like to do is kind of put some scenarios to you on customers at different points in their migration journey. And you can kind of tell us how Cloud Adoption Framework can help those customers. Does that sound like a good idea?
Sounds like a great idea.
Awesome. So let's, for example, say I'm a customer who's just starting out in my cloud migration journey. I'm maybe, you know, thinking about which provider I go with and what I'm going to do. What can Cloud Adoption Framework help me? How can it help me in that area of my migration?
Yeah, so aka.ms/adopt, jump in there. And I'll kind of, as I'm talking through these scenarios, I'll show you where you can actually pick up some of this info. So we've got these various pillars of getting started, and then each of the pillars of the adoption framework. Strategy and plan is really the place that most customers are going to want to start. If you haven't built a plan or you're not sure what to do, this is going to give you that guidance and direction around what are your motivations, your business outcomes, how should I organize my team, what are the skills that are needed in my teams and the roles that are needed. And then we actually have resources and technology to be able to help you navigate through these different decision points through kind of DevOps projects as well as templates to help build out that plan.
Awesome. So let's say I'm beyond my planning phase and I'm at that point now where I'm ready to start and, you know, get some of my resources up into the cloud and start and move some of that infrastructure over. How does Cloud Adoption Framework help me at that point in my cloud journey?
Well, if you jump into kind of the ready and govern phase, this is the place that techies really love to kind of, you know, get involved, because this is where the first time they start playing with the actual resources. And so we've done a bunch of great work around building out landing zone or reference architectures. This is called enterprise scale. You can find that within the ready phase. That also gives you guidance around governance. We have a really rich methodology that kind of talks through that approach to addressing governance in your organization. We've got assessments that you can actually do. And so kind of really just solidifying that platform and making sure that you have the right landing zone security, networking connectivity, as well as governance controls and guardrails in place. That's a great place for that scenario.
So some really great tools there to help people along their journey. But we all know that the cloud journey doesn't stop just because I got my first server migrated to the cloud. What can CAF offer customers who already have those resources up there and are looking to maintain their cloud environment ongoing?
Well, we've got lots of rich guidance around kind of how to migrate and innovate. And so when you start to evolve those workloads and those applications, so you talk about moving existing applications, but you may want to evolve those. And so we've kind of got this whole innovation guidance that gets given to them. And then on top of that, how do we think about managing and operating in these environments, creating operational baseline and fitness reviews and ensuring that we are running very, very optimally. And then once you've got those signals coming out of the management environment, we can actually now start to evolve the way that we optimize or the way that we operationalize that environment using the well-architected methodology. And that helps us kind of do optimization on cost, on reliability, on security, ensuring that we're really architecting applications in the right way.
So some really great resources there to help people no matter where they are in their cloud journey. Wayne, thank you so much for taking the time to join us.
Hey, it's been an absolute pleasure, and thanks for inviting me.
And of course, if you want to learn more about Cloud Adoption Framework or any of the technologies that you've heard talked about today, you can see the links on screen now. Of course, if you want to follow us on social, you'll get all the latest updates and all the newest episodes and interviews and customer stories. And we look forward to seeing you on the next Customer Tech Talks.